science unveils an amazing new calculator that solves problems quicker than mathematicians can think them up.
In the 50s and 60s, things were different.
The bowler hat brigade of the 815 to London got ready for action.
Computers filled entire rooms. Bank robbers wore masks. And conflict looked like this. It's an understatement to say that a lot has changed in 70 years. Nowadays, computers fit on your wrist. A bank robber doesn't need to leave their desk. And war is increasingly remote. What started with the letters LOG being sent between teams at UCLA and Stanford in October of 1969 has ended up revolutionizing almost every industry on the planet. Without computers connected over the internet, we can't bank, we can't travel, we can't drive, we can't eat, we can't communicate, we can't function as a modern society. But what blows my mind is that after half a century of development, this technology is a minefield.
The biggest fuel pipeline system in the United States remains crippled by a cyber attack.
Hackers were able to steal $81 million from the country's central bank.
Every organization out there can probably do at least a little bit better on their security.
This is an international attack.
Somebody will find a way in.
This is the story of why our data will never be safe. It shouldn't be this way. The companies that make all of this tech are the richest companies on the planet. And there's a boatload of cybersecurity companies trying to make this technology more safe. Yet still, every single day, people lose their life savings. And businesses keep getting taken offline by ransomware gangs. So why isn't all this cutting edge and extremely expensive technology stopping these attacks? Here's why. Because being 100% secure is impossible.
Say what?
But in order to understand why cybersecurity is impossible, you first have to understand these little things called humans. And it all starts with one of their biggest flaws, trust. You can control the length of your password. You can decide whether you have two-factor authentication or not. You can control which links you click and the files you download, but you can't control what goes on behind the scenes at Apple, Google, Facebook, Microsoft. You have no choice but to blindly trust the technology you buy from them. And I know what some of you are thinking, but what about Linux? It's open source, we can see the code. Linux has its bugs as well, nothing's perfect. Because very little gets in the way of human error. People are at the heart of what makes technology insecure. People design and make the hardware. People write the code that runs on that hardware. People use the end product. And I'm sure you know that people aren't flawless. We all make mistakes. So at any point in time, you could be using a really great computer or one full of bugs. So let's recap. We have imperfect hardware running imperfect software operated by imperfect people. Combine all of that with the internet, and you can start to see why hackers can carry out very successful attacks. But there's much more to it. I want you to think about your favorite book. Here's one I'm reading, Sandworm by Andy Greenberg. Once you've read it, that's it. The story's over. But now I want you to imagine that the book keeps changing as you read it. New chapters appear, entire chapters disappear, pages move around. It would be impossible to ever complete and really understand a book like that. And that's exactly how technology is. When you buy the latest phone and install the latest software, you bring in new hardware, new features in the software, you fix old bugs, but you also bring in new bugs. And let me tell you, bugs are everywhere. I'm gonna go on a limb here and say that there have probably been bugs in every human invention since we could ever create. Computer bugs are pretty cool. They're different from most bugs because they're tracked. Computer bugs are actually called CVEs, which means common vulnerabilities and exposures. CVEs started being tracked in 1999 by a company called the MITRE Corporation. They're a non-profit. They helped the US government develop the early internet, which was called the ARPANET. And in 1999, when the first bugs were tracked, 894 were accepted onto the list. Last year, 2020, they found 18,000 more than they found that first year. There were more bugs found from the start of 2017 to the end of 2020 than in all the years previous combined. Now, there's a couple of reasons for this. One is we're making way more software now than we ever have before. You know, all the apps. The second reason is that there's a thing called bug bounty programs now. That's where, if you're interested, you could sign up to this program and hunt bugs. And if you find bugs, you can get paid for it. And the payments range from $0 and a pat on the back to $2 million the last time I checked. But there's this category of bugs called zero days or O days. A zero day is a bug found by someone before the company has become aware of it. Because the company hasn't a clue about the bug, no patch exists for this bug. And that means that hackers are likely to be very successful in their attacks if they use it. There are a few zero-day tracking projects. Google has one called Project Zero. They're tracking zero days that are being found in the wild, which means in real attacks, not through independent research on the side of a desk. And Google's team says that on average, every 17 days, a new zero day is seen in the wild. And more often than not, they're chained together to form an exploit chain. Let me give you an example. In March 2021, Microsoft were forced to issue emergency patches to their worldwide email servers called Exchange. They did this because suspected Chinese hackers were exploiting not one, not two, not three, but four zero days. And remember, these servers are used all across the world by the world's biggest businesses. These servers were also sold to those businesses as safe and secure, fit for purpose. And unfortunately, that wasn't the case. The people who designed it, the people who built it, the people who installed it, the people who used it, none of them knew about this bug. And these in the wild zero days are on the rise. Not known to the company who invented the software, not known to the security companies trying to keep us all safe, no one but the attacker, except maybe the government. So this next one's pretty easy to grasp, and it's also quite controversial because on one hand, it keeps us safe, and on the other hand, it makes us all very vulnerable. We know governments like to keep their secrets. So state-backed hackers like the NSA, GCHQ, Unit 8200, Russia, the Chinese, and many more are constantly trying to find bugs in systems. If they find one, they'll keep it hush-hush so they can use it against their enemies.
We are in a cyber war. Most Americans don't know it. Most folks in the world probably don't know it. And at this point, we're losing.
Some want to disrupt global terrorism. Others want to gather industrial espionage.
Russia's been accused of it recently with SolarWinds, but certainly the US, the UK and others also carry out espionage.
In the West, we have this thing called the Vulnerabilities Equities Process. It's a process that lets governments figure out if they should tell the manufacturer about a bug or keep it secret. And there's a very well-known example of this going horribly wrong. We don't know when, but at some point in the past, the NSA found a bug in Windows and they sat on it. They didn't tell Microsoft. They didn't say, "Hey, Microsoft, you've got this problem." They saw the problem and kept it quiet. And they weaponized it. And then all of a sudden, that weapon ended up in the hands of a group called the Shadow Brokers. That group released a whole bunch of stolen NSA tools on Twitter. And then in 2017, companies and organizations all over the world got hit with WannaCry ransomware. It targeted Windows computer systems and spread across networks like wildfire. When WannaCry hit the National Health Service in the UK, it knocked off lots of really important equipment. Tens of thousands of computers, MRI scanners, blood refrigerators, even operating theaters were taken offline. Brad Smith from Microsoft called out the NSA's poor behavior, and he said, "An equivalent scenario with conventional weapons would be the US military having some of its Tomahawk missiles stolen." So as you've probably come to realize, nothing is perfect. And with that in mind, you might be wondering, what about my antivirus? Does it not stop hackers? Security tools like antivirus are just more software with a security focus. Just because you install it doesn't mean you're secure. And to prove that, let's look at VirusTotal. VirusTotal is a company that's owned by Google. They collect malware, which is malicious software. Here's a well-known malware sample. In fact, this is WannaCry. According to VirusTotal, this malware isn't being detected by a handful of cybersecurity companies. So if you use one of these tools, you might not be safe from this particular file. So where do we go from here? Hopefully now you understand a little bit more about some of the factors that are at play in this crazy world of cybersecurity. The key takeaway from all of this is that you should never just rely on a single layer of protection. All technology is like Swiss cheese. There are holes. And to be as secure as possible, you need to layer up. That'll make it much less attractive for the bad guys to try and weave their way through the Swiss cheese of your network over a single layer of protection on someone else's network. Now, sometimes those bad guys are governments with unlimited resources, and they will get in. There's just nothing you can do to stop that. Hopefully someone invents something revolutionary that completely changes how we think and behave online from a security perspective. But until then, the only way I know how to be 100% hack-proof is to